about event-driven programming or event programming. And we'll basically talk about different issues in event programming and how to deal with events in GraphQL user interfaces. Let's check that everybody can see and hear, and we are currently recording. Yes. Okay. So event programming is the third type of programming that we are learning in this class. We learn procedural programming at the beginning. It's basically when you have a method or a procedure and the statements in that procedure are executed in order that they appear from top to bottom. That's called procedural programming. Then we talked about object-oriented programming, where we basically have a pattern, which is the class, to define objects, and then one instantiates objects of that pattern. So we created different kinds of classes, like geometric object with subclasses, circle and rectangle, and we created instances. That's another paradigm in programming. The next part of paradigm that we'll talk about today is event-driven programming or event programming, where code is executed upon the activation of events. So usually this is used in GraphQL user interfaces. Like, for instance, you have a window with several buttons. You click on a button. What happens is actually that the operating system constantly monitors for such events like mouse clicks, key strokes. It identifies which of the programs that currently is shown in the desktop, on the desktop, is basically interacted with. So it sorts these events into the programs that actually they are reported on and reports them to those appropriate programs. So now it becomes a problem of the JavaFX or the framework to capture that event and run it with the event handler for that component. So where do we come in? We basically write event handlers for each control. Every GraphQL user interface component, like button, combo box, and so on, we have to define the event handler for that specific component. So first we define a class in Java, like object-oriented programming. Then we construct an instance of that event handler class. And then we tell the control that that event handler object, it's its event listener. So what exactly is an event handler? Is the code with the response to an event. So for instance, a button has attached an instance of an event handler that handles that button, like it prints OK, or it updates the database, reading the text fields that are in the rest of the GraphQL user interface, and so on. Now, in JavaFX, an event source is any GraphQL user interface control, like, for instance, buttons, choice boxes, lists, and so on. In effect, any one of the classes below. So anything that is a subclass of control. Control is a subclass of parent, which is a subclass of node. Anything under control, labeled, which means any buttons or labels, scroll bars, sliders, text input control, those are text areas or text fields, list views, combo boxes, they all have they are sources of events, and they can be used to capture these events and execute some code captured in the event handler when this button or this control is interacted with. Now, depending on the different source of control of different type of sources, we can detect different types of events. Therefore, we can also register different types of listeners or handlers. So for instance, on a button, we can identify clicks. On in a text area, we can identify keystrokes. So basically, based on what's the type of control, we can define event handlers that capture those types of events, mouse clicks or key events or action events and so on. So what exactly are these events? They are also objects in Java. So they contain, they are instances of a class event. They contain information about the event. Like for instance, where was the mouse click? In case that the mouse click was clicked while the shift or the control keys were pressed. The key source is also identified. So it has a reference back to what was the control that this event was detected on. And for keystrokes, it contains actually the key that was actually clicked on, like let's say E or A or F or space and so on. So the listeners that we define are basically identifying this type of events, and different methods are used for different types of events. And we'll basically see how to attach these event handlers and different types of event handlers to the sources, to the components on the graphical user interface. So just to recap, how do we handle graphical user interface events? An event is generated by an external action, a user action such as a mouse movement, a mouse click, or kick strokes. An event is a type of signal to the program that something has happened. We define event listeners, and these listener objects contain methods to process that event. So on a source like a button, the moment that a click happens, an event is triggered. This object is created by the JVM and it calls a method handler, an event handler that processes that type of event. And in fact, the event is a parameter to the handler. So basically the handler can extract different properties from the event itself. Now, what do we do? Basically in Java, a similar process happens. When a user interacts with a control, an event object is constructed by the JVM. The event object is sent to all of the registered listener objects, these objects that were created by us, the programmer, to basically handle the events that happen on that type of source. And the event handler responds as you defined it to, like updating the database, updating the GUI itself. So the event handler is defined by you. It's the application programmer. You customize the response to an event by writing the code that will be executed when that event happens. And how do we define an event handler? An event handler uses a lot of object-oriented programming. Basically, you have to define a listener class that implements the appropriate interface like that handles that type of the event for that component and define the responses in the necessary methods. So you define a class, then you create Java will create an instance. Actually, you create an instance and attach it to as an event handler to that source, to basically the graphical user interface component. And here is the first example. So basically in this class, as you can see, we import a lot of JavaFX classes. We learned about some of these last time. So we import application, that is a JavaFX application, our class event, handle event extends application. That requires to implement the start method, which takes the primary stage, the window, as a parameter. Then we create an horizontal box that contains two buttons, OK and cancel. The button for OK is created. It's also imported as a control from JavaFX scene control. Then we create a handler called handler one of the type OK handler. OK handler is a subclass of event handler. So as you can see, I defined the class in the same file. I defined the handle method, which is inherited as an abstract method from the basically the interface event handler. So this will be the method that is basically in JavaFX to be implemented by any handler any event handler. Then we set that handler will handle any action that happens on button one. So if one clicks right or clicks left, the button OK, it calls that handler. And the handler basically prints in the command prompt in the console, OK, button clicked. And similarly, we create a handle for the cancel event, and we set it as the correct handler for the button cancel. We add both the OK and cancel buttons to the horizontal pane that we created before, HBox that we created before. We create the scene that contains the pane that we just populated with two buttons. We set the scene to be the scene in the primary stage, and we show the primary stage. Now, when you run this program in Java, it basically creates a window with two buttons and the command prompt that prints every time you click on one of the buttons. And as I did before, every one of the classes that you have in the lecture notes is completely runnable. So in fact, let me create them and run them as we go over the lecture notes. So this is a handle events. We are going to put it in the default workspace and no packages necessary. Okay, so we basically can run this, and this program basically created a simple window with two buttons, a button OK and a button cancel. Every time you click OK, it prints a message, OK button clicked, in the console, because that's what the handler for the OK button does. It basically calls system.out.println OK button clicked. And similarly for cancel, every time you click cancel, it executes the handler for that type of the event. Now, you can also handle the events that you basically generate on these through interaction on these buttons to update a label or a text area directly in the GraphQL user interface. We'll talk a little bit more about that later today. Okay, so this is our first event programming JavaFX application. But basically, we attach handlers to the buttons that we created in the interface, okay? Now, this is a little bit verbose, but it contains the entire information that needs to be done when we create actually handlers. We create handler classes, which extend the interfaces that are required by JavaFX for standardizing the methods that will be called in case that one interacts with that component. Then we create an instance object of those handler classes that we created explicitly. And then we attach to the button or the source the corresponding handler with the method setOnAction. So this is exactly what is required for any kind of component that you want to update something on the screen. Now, it's a little bit verbose. We have to create a class, we have to create the objects, we have to attach them. So this is a little bit verbose, but we'll see later that we can update it, make it much easier. We can basically create anonymous handlers, inner classes, and then we can actually do it independently from the compiler itself. We can basically use Lambda expressions to actually create an anonymous class on the fly, which basically cleans up a lot of this code. Before we talk about what is the model of updating web pages, let's see if there are any questions in the chat. Always feel free to ask questions loudly, because I only can see the chat after I stop for a while. So first question from Sterjan is, can you explain what the action event means in the event handler? So event handler is a generic class. Basically, it allows to parameterize the type of the events that it can handle. So later, in fact, next semester, we will talk about generic classes and interfaces. And what this is a way to specify what is the type of elements in these generic classes. So remember the ArrayList. So in the ArrayList class, you can specify using these greater than, less than symbols, the type of the elements in ArrayList. This is exactly the same. It specifies that the type of events that we handle in this handler are of the type action event. They are not of the type key event or mouse click event and so on. So you basically specify for this specific handler what's the type of the event that it handles. Okay. Now, those less than and greater than are not necessary. In fact, once we actually learn about Lambda functions, you will see that it goes away, the whole event handler, because it already knows what is the type of the event that it handles. So you don't actually end the type of the event handler. So it, in fact, you don't need to use this afterwards. But it's generic programming, in short. Now, the next question by Rohan is the handle method called implicitly? Yes. JavaFX as a framework, if an event happens on that source event or GraphQL user interface component, JavaFX framework will call the handle method. So you don't invoke the handle method yourself. It will be done by Java. Adit probably responds to Serjan. The action event is a way to specify the event handler kind of event that it will be dealing with exactly. I think there are multiple kinds of events. Yes, there are basically different kinds of events. We'll see them in a couple of slides, basically action events, input events, window events, mouse events, and key events. And these are only some because, for instance, for touch screens, there are swipe events and all kinds of events that you don't see here. So what is an action event, or is it just to add it to buttons? Yes, it's basically there is one class that is already created as the parent of all kinds of events, which is the event class, and they needed another event type for a subclass that handles button clicks. And yes, most of the events that we will see later. In fact, here you can see that there are different methods to attach handlers to specific sources are action events. Are basically just a generic name for an event that doesn't carry any kind of additional information but the fact that an event happened. So it basically has the time when it happened and was the source. So it's a generic type of event as opposed to mouse that has the location where the mouse click happened within the current component, within the entire window, or the absolute location on the screen, as opposed to key events that also carry the Unicode of the key that was basically clicked and so on. So it's a generic event. Okay. Now, JavaFX and, in fact, any kind of graphical user interface component for a framework for standalone applications are using what is called the delegation model. So the delegation model is that if you have a source, like, for instance, a button, the button doesn't implement the handler itself. What it has a method set on action that allows you to actually list all of the possible listeners, multiple possibly, that will be called if an event is triggered on this specific source. So it basically uses an aggregation that it keeps a link or a reference to the listeners, and usually those listeners implement an event handler or an interface. So the control itself, it knows to call a specific method. So, like, for instance, the method handle. So it standardizes what method will be called the moment that an event happens on that component. And this is called delegation model. So it's the simplest possible way to attach a listener to a graphical user interface component and update that component, or basically update the listener on the fly without having to basically modify the class itself or to actually hard code what will be the user created methods that will be called in case that an event happens. So this is called a delegation model. It allows one to attach listeners on the fly at runtime to a source class or like, for instance, a control class in JavaFX. And that class can be, again, created separately, but it has to implement a certain interface. So the source knows which methods to call such that it basically executes the listener. So here we have basically two screens. We have the general UML diagram for the delegation model, and we have a concrete example where a button object is attached a listener with an action event. Now let's return back to events. So an event object contains properties that are pertinent to the event. Like for instance, the source. What was the object on which this event was detected? It returns a reference subclass of the Java class object, which basically it that reference, it basically it's a reference to the source that this event was created on. The subclasses of event object deal with special type of events such as button events, window events, like when you minimize a window, when you close a window, component events, mouse events, and keystrokes. And this is basically the main event classes present in JavaFX. The only one that is missing, or actually the only ones that are missing, are the touch screen events for those screens that allow you to touch them and interact with. Okay. So basically, we already talked about this type of events. Now, depending on the user action and the source object, we have basically different events fired. So clicking on a button fires an action event, pressing enter in a text field again creates an action event. Checking or unchecking a radio box or a checkbox creates action events. Selecting an item in a combo list triggers an action event, and so on. Basically, mouse pressed, clicked, and so on generate mouse events, and key pressed generate key events. And then we have all of the methods that are used to attach the different kind of events to components. And you can attach multiple event handlers to components. So for instance, on a pane, you can attach an event handler for mouse clicked, and you can attach an event handler for mouse dragged. That's basically when you click and then you drag, and every moment, every new pixel that the mouse is on, it generates an event. So let's see a couple of examples. We get now into more complicated graphical user interfaces that update, not only, they don't only write the some output in the command prompt in the console, but they also update the graphical user interface component itself. So in this example, I create first a class that extends geometric extends application is called control circle. Internally, it has a property called circle pane. It's a simple pane that contains a circle object. Then we have a start method that creates an horizontal box for the two buttons enlarge and shrink and adds the two buttons after they were created. Then it calls the method setOnAction. It attaches an event handler, a new enlarge handler, to the button for enlarge. Similarly, I could have attached a new event handler for the button shrink, but I basically left it for you to modify. Then I created a border pane in which I put in the middle the circle pane and on the bottom the horizontal box. So now the enlarge handler is defined inside the control circle itself. So basically what the inner classes can do, it can call any method or it can access any reference of data field inside the outer class. So in this case, we call enlarge on the circle pane, the property circle pane that was defined inside as a property inside the control circle application. And what it does, it basically enlarges the circle in that circle pane. I will show you in a second. So now we have the main method, which calls the JavaFX thread with launch application, and then it basically disappears. And we have the circle pane class, which is an inner, which is a class defined in the same file, which extends stack pane. It creates a circle with radius of 50 and initially is put in the middle of the current screen. So we add the circle to the current stack pane, which is in the middle. It sets the stroke to black and the field color to white. And then it, we have the method for enlarge, which enlarges the radius of the circle with 2 pixels, and shrink, which decreases the radius of the circle with 2 pixels. Okay. Yes.
So how does, can you go back to the previous slide that you were just on? How does the class enlarge handler have access to the circle pane object?
Excellent. It's defined inside the control circle. So if you look at the parentheses, this is actually inside the outer class. So we actually are going to discuss about inner classes. Inner classes are those classes which are declared internally to an outer class. And by default, any inner class can reference either directly the data. So for instance, this data field was defined in the outer class, and the inner class, any object instance of the inner class that was created in the outer class can access the data fields of the outer class. So in our case, we actually increment directly data from the outer class from the inner class. And this is the same behavior that happens for listeners. So a listener is a class defined inside an outer class, and by default, it has access to all of the data fields of the outer class, including it can actually call, enlarge, or shrink on the circle pane object. You understand?
Yep.
Okay. So actually, that's a good question because we can actually see a simple example. So we can create a class. Let's call it outer. And in this outer class, we can define a data field. Let's call it integer data is equal with 1. We can have a constructor for outer. Which maybe the only thing that it does is to create an inner class. The inner class is an inner class to the outer class. And let's define a constructor for inner class. And so what we can do from the inner class, we can actually have access to the outer class data field. And now in the main method, we can actually create Let's create an object of the author class. And if we print for this object, the data, you will see that it was incremented from 1 to 2. So any object created inside an instance of an outer class, as long as they are inner classes, they can have access to the data fields and methods of the outer class. And that's exactly the case that we have for listeners. A listener is defined inside a GUI class, a Graph User Interface application class. Therefore, it can access the data fields for the outer class. So again, let's actually see it in Java. So I'm going to create again a new class, Control Circle. Let's copy the entire program from both slides. And it's a complete program. Basically, if you start it, you will have a circle and you can enlarge it for the moment. It's easy to add shrinking. But enlarging basically means you are increasing the radius of that circle. So that's basically what this program did. It basically created an inner class that is handles when somebody clicks on the button for enlarge. So we attach as an action, set on action, the event handler, enlarge handler for the button enlarge. And this can be easily basically modified to implement the button for shrink. So if I would have, let's actually implement it. So we need an inner class for the button for shrink. So we change the class name. And instead of calling enlarge, it calls shrink. It's already implemented, and we actually have to attach the handler for shrink. So instead of enlarge, we have shrink. And if somebody clicks on it, it shrinks the handler object. Now we need to changes shrink. Okay, so let's run it as usual. And now we have the button for enlarge and the button for shrink. So we modified it quite well. Okay, good. So inner classes basically are any object instance of the inner class has access to all of the GUI fields of the outer class where it was created. An inner class is designed specifically to add to a listener class is designed for creating a listener object for a GUI component, usually a single method. And because it's inside the GraphUser interface, it has to have access to all of the other GUI components, so it basically can update them or even disable them. So to get back, an inner class is a class that is defined inside another class, like a member of the other class. So here we have an example. The outer class has a data field equal with 0. The outer set constructor creates an instance of the inner class Y, and it calls the method M2. The method M1 is defined for the outer class, and what it does, it increments the data with 1. We have a method main, which creates an object of the outer class X, and then it prints x.data. The inner class is defined inside the outer class, and it basically defines the method m2. And the method m2 increments the data once and then calls the method m1, which increments it again. So basically, an inner class is inside another class and can access all of the data fields of the outer class. Just to show you again that this is actually working, let's actually create a new Java class, and we're going to call it outer class. And I'm going to leave the package definition and run it. And we can see that it printed 2. It started with data equal with 0, then the method m2 was called on the inner class. The method m2 increments from 0 to 1, calls the method m1. The method m1 increments data from 1 to 2. It finishes, it returns to the method m2. It finishes, and we basically return to the main method. We create an instance of the outer class. But at this moment, x.data is equal with 2 because data was incremented twice. We incremented it when we basically in the method m2, the inner class, and then from m2 we called m1, which incremented it again with 1. So an inner class can be defined public, protected, or private, subject to the same visibility rules as before. Public means can be used by outer classes, even in other packages. Protected means that it can be used only by subclasses, either in the current package or another package. Or private means that it's only used in the current class and no one else. An inner class can also be defined static. And the static inner class can be accessed during the runtime preceded by the outer class name. So for instance, for our listener, it could have been the source file name point period the listener object. So it basically can define sub inner classes that are static. However, a static inner class cannot have access to non-public members. So you only define it as static when you want to keep general properties. Now, we saw that this approach is quite verbose. We basically had to define a class, create object instances of those classes, and attach them to the source class. So basically, how can we shorten it? The first way is that we usually know what classes we will implement, and we only do it in most cases once. So what we can do, we can use anonymous inner classes or inner classes without a name. It basically combines declaring the inner class, which was done separately, with creating the instance of the inner class and attach it to the correct listener. So the first idea is we can actually, given an interface or a superclass name, we can actually create an instance of a subclass of that interface or of that class directly in the place where it's used. So let's say that we have a set on action, and then we actually create that subclass. We don't have to use explicit extends or explicit implements. We just state new and the interface name, or new and the class, abstract class name. Now, one thing about these kind of classes is that you have to always use the default constructor. So basically, if you used up to now default constructors for other instances, now they will be defined for the current instance. Okay. Only the default constructor. So here I have an example. So before I had the class enlarge handler that implemented handle, and in the set on action, we call the constructor for enlarge handler. Now we can actually get rid of that and the separate class defined in a different spot, and just basically state that set enlarge set on action applies to a new event handler object, and then the implementation of the handle method. So what you can see, we actually got rid of the name of that handle method, which was the enlarge handle handler, and we got rid of implements. We basically directly said what interface or what abstract class are we implementing directly in your program. So here we have an example. In the previous example, we had the button for new and open in the first example, or OK and cancel. Instead of defining the new event handler separately after the current class, we define them right where they are attached to the correct source. So where we set on action the button new, we basically put a code for that button. We can state that this is a new event handler and this is the handle method. So basically, this is the same, almost the same program as before. If you copy the name of the class and you create a new example, and again, we are going to copy the entire program and the fact that we are setting the scene to contain these specific objects, and run this program line by line as we saw it in the program, we can see that we have the two buttons for new and for open. And we did it in much shorter space than before. We basically define the event handlers right where the button is attached, that event handler. So this is quite updated and current. Now, the truth is that even this is too verbose. So programmers were looking for a while how to simplify this. And the simplest thing that you can see is that given the source, we know exactly what is the method, like set on action, and what's the type of the event that is captured. So what we can do is basically use an anonymous inner class, and later to actually use a handler that already knows what's the type of the class, which is called the lambda. So a few notes on anonymous inner classes. An anonymous inner class must always extend a superclass or implement an interface, but cannot have explicit extends and implement clauses. An anonymous inner class must implement all abstract methods defined in the superclass or in the interface. An anonymous inner class always uses the no argument constructor, which I told you earlier, from its superclass to create an instance. So we don't call specific constructors. We basically create objects on the fly using the default constructor. Now, this is still a little bit long. So we basically have the code on the left-hand side, which calls set on action, and then it creates an instance of that specific interface. So we override the method handle, and then in the method handle we finally have the code in that inner class for processing that type of the event, updating the GUI or the database. Now in Java 8, which was released in 2014, a new concept was implemented called lambda expressions. They are predefined functions for the type of the input with the default type of that input, the function to show that input. So an lambda expression can be viewed as an anonymous method for a concise syntax. And we can see here that before we had set on action, which creates a new enlarge handler, then it overrides the method handle. Now we can do all of that in one single line. The button enlarge, set on action, an event happened, and now it knows that must be an event, action event, triggers, and then you basically have to put a code of what gets updated in case that lambda was detected. So here we have an example. Basically, we have the same program as before, with the exception that instead of creating an instance of handle, we are basically implementing right now, right here. We basically, the event is captured and triggers printing new, printing open, printing save, and printing print. So again, let's try it. So lambda event handler. And let's copy the entire file. Okay. So now every time we click one of the four buttons, it basically prints a different message because the event handlers for the four different buttons were different. Okay. So what's the basic syntax for a lambda expression? We have to enumerate the parameters for the method that is the only method defined in that interface. And then the statements after an arrow that will be executed sequentially if the event was detected. The data type for the parameter can maybe explicitly defined or implicitly inferred from the method that we are calling. Like set on action requires an action event, set mouse drag sets a mouse event, and so on. If the input is a single variable, then you can omit the parentheses. So each one of these two can basically be removed the parentheses. Now, the type of interfaces that are implemented in JavaFX as event listeners are called single abstract method interfaces. Basically, for any program compiler to understand lambda expressions, an interface must contain exactly one abstract method. So basically, we know that the interface that corresponds to any handler must have a single method. Because if the interface contained multiple and we had that lambda expression that if event E was detected, this is the method called. If the interface contains multiple methods, it doesn't know which one to compile it to lambda expressions. Also, these kind of like interfaces are called basically single abstract method interfaces, or SAMs. So let's see a couple of more complicated examples. So here we have an example in which we have text fields for the annual interest rate, number of years, and loan amount. And then we have three populated boxes based on these values that were entered. And we can basically see that it contains the annual interest rate, the number of years, and the loan amount. And the computer will compute for us what is the monthly payment considering compound interest, and what is the total payment basically over the number of months that the loan was paid. So again, in order to see it better, let's create it in JavaFX. So we created the Java file, and now I'm going to copy the entire program. It's quite a large program, so let's put everything. Here. Leave it and run it. So let's say that we put $1,000 over 1 year loan amount. So $1,000. 10% interest rate number of years is one, and the loan amount is $1,000. We end up paying $87.59 per month, and which basically means $1,054.99. So it works pretty well. Now, another type of event that is detected by Java GraphQL interfaces are mouse events. So mouse events contain not only the source, but also other types of data fields. We can get the number of clicks in the associated with this event, the X and Y coordinates with respect to the GraphQL interface of Java, the scene X and scene Y coordinates returns the Y, the X coordinate of the mouse pointing in the scene, and so on. So let's see an example. In this example, I'm creating a text programming is fun, and then I create to that text, I set on mouse clicked to basically get the X set one examples and get the text two examples. So let's see this example. So let's create a class mouse event demo. Let's run it. And if you click, you can drag that text anywhere you want. Because what we are basically doing, we bind the location of this programming is fun to the X and Y coordinates given by the mouse drag the event. So if you return back, you can see that I added the text to the children. Then the text will basically have on mouse direct event E, execute the following code, copy, or basically take, set the value of the text in text to the values of X and Y in the circle, in the current stage. Okay. And that's basically the entire program to manipulate with the mouse, a certain object on the screen. Okay. The next type of the event that we'll talk about is the key event. So the key event basically detects an event which is of the type key. That means that one of the sources has as an attached handler the current handler, and get character returns a string. Get code returns the code, the key code in the Unicode for that input first letter that we saw before. Get text returns the text describing the text code, the key code. Is alt down, is control down. These are basically all methods that are in the key event class. So here we have an example in which we are actually using key events. So key event demo extends application. It defines the method start and it attaches it a new pane and a pane of 20 by 20 by 5 by A. It sets the focus traversable false, and then it basically sets the text in the current children pane and sets on key pressed. If the event E is detected on the one of the letters, like for instance A and W, then we switch on that code. If the key was down, it increments the Y coordinate, the previous Y coordinate, with 10 pixels before redrawing it automatically. Similarly, up decreases the Y, left decreases the x and right increases the x. So let's run it in Java. So let's create a new class, KeyVanDemo. And run it. So as you can see, right now I'm actually moving those, the letter A, using the keyboard, left, right, up, down. So it's working properly. Okay. Now, inside here, basically, when we are actually comparing if the code is equal with up, down, left, and right, I'm using constants defined in the enumeration key code. And it contains basically other constants like the home key to detect when the home key was clicked, the end key, page down, page down, page up. Up and down are the arrows and also the keys to interact with the GUIs using key events. Right, basically it's a right arrow key. Escape is the escape key and so on. So basically these are enumerations which are imported by default in Java because enumerations are all defined and imported in the user space. Now, if you want to attach multiple handlers, you can attach them, or you can even attach the same handler, but with a source check to different modes of interaction. So here we basically have a handler that enlarges using a button click, but also one actually can click on the circle and click right button, the primary button, actually click left button for right-handed. The primary button will enlarge the circle and the secondary button will decrease the size of the circle. Listeners can be defined not only on GUI components, but also on other observable objects. In particular, the properties in JavaFX are observable. And you can use the same methods that we learn in GUIs, add listener to add a listener, for this type of observable events. And here I have an example. I created a double property balance, which is by default equal with zero. Then I added a listener to my balance object, the property. And this new invalidation listener implements the invalidated method, which basically prints the new value of the balance of doubles. So again, this is an entire program. Anytime you want, you can basically just copy the entire program and see what it does. You can even play it with the debugger, so you see basically step by step what happened in your program. So let's copy the entire program. And run it like usual. Okay. So we can see the new value is 4.5. And the reason why the new value is 4.5 is that we had the listener to the observable object and we actually printed that message in that listener. So the listener was the one that actually printed the message on the output. Now, JavaFX also has animation. So this is the difference between Swing and other older graphical user interface components and JavaFX. JavaFX allows you to define your own animation, a path transition on what kind of like a line or object the camera, the animation will be generated, and what's the period in which this animation basically is generated. So basically for a user, he would be updated every, let's say, nanosecond to see the correct figure in the animation. And we start with the simplest possible animation called path transition. So a path transition take constructor takes the node source itself, takes the duration of the animation, the orientation path, like clockwise or counterclockwise, if it's a circle, and the path, which is basically the shape whose outline is used to, as a path to animate the node move. So here I have an example. I basically create a path transition for 4 seconds. And during 4 seconds, basically we set that the direction of the path of this object that is in the basically inside on the side of a circle, that will be the path. And then we have the node that will be moved relative to that circle. So again, cut path transition demo. Let's create a new class. So I will explain it in a couple of seconds after I show it to you. It's easier to understand when I'm showing it to you. Okay, and run it. So we can see that it has one trajectory, which is relative to a path that was given at the beginning. And then it has the object that is moved on that trajectory, which is basically the rectangle that we have in this figure. Okay. So let's see what happened. So the first part is kind of identical with what we saw up to now. I created a panel, I created the rectangle, I put the panel in the rectangle, and similarly, I created a circle and I put it in the panel. Then we have to create a path transition. So the path transition says that during 4 seconds for the entire animation, the path of this object, so the center of gravity of the object is put on the path. And then for 4 seconds, it internally computes how many frames it needs to actually show the movement. Okay. Then we set the orientation of this partial path to be orthogonal to the tangent. So it basically looks the way it is with circling around the center of the previous pane, then, which in our case is a clock. Then we set auto reverse to true, and we set the play, we started playing this set orientation demo. So in our case, basically we have a button for pause the moment that the mouse is clicked, and the button for release the moment that the mouse is released. So let's see this program. So actually, I already showed it to you. Another example, but it's quite similar. It actually raises the flag based on a path, which is a single line from position 100 to 200 to 100 to 0. So it basically puts the flag. Okay. Fade transitions. Fade transitions are those in which a node changes its opacity. Like for instance, you are able to see through a less opaque object like glass, but you can't see through steel. It's a much denser object. So in our case, I have an example, the fade transition demo. Let me show you first. Okay. So now we have the entire program as usual. And once we start running it, we can basically see that it changes its opacity. So it goes from totally red to almost transparent. If we had objects in the back, it will basically, they will be seen. Now, path And fade transitions are just specific types of animations. You define a path for the path transition or the fade for fading. But JavaFX has a more complicated class called timeline, which can be used to join any programming animation using JavaFX animations keyframes. A keyframe defines a target value at a specified point in time for a set of variables, like for instance, what's the end value for the Y coordinate in a graphical user interface component. Now, this keyframe, it basically defines, it's run sequentially after a certain time interval. So one specifies the time interval, and then the keyframe, the updates that are made to the graphical user interface component. So here I have an example. Blinking programming is fun. So the way that it works is that we basically create a timeline, and for that timeline, we set that it basically has a duration of 500 milliseconds, so almost 1 second, or half of a second, in fact. Then we set the count cycle time to be indefinite, like the biggest possible integer, and we start play, which basically plays that blinking light. And again, I'm going to show it to you. So I'm going to create a new class, time demo, timeline demo. And we run it. And we see that is blinking programming is fun. Okay. Good. And I have two more complicated programs in the lecture notes. Basically, a time clock animation, which basically shows a clock that moves every second. So the duration of the keyframe is 1 second, and the event handler will be called every 1 second to increment the time with one. And then basically, or just print the current time to the event, to the command prompt. I will skip the clock pane because it's basically just a class to represent the time using the hour, minute, and second. Okay. Paint clock. So the paint clock paints that specific clock that we saw before. And it has basically geometry embedded. So we can see where the clock will be put relative to the value, maximum value of clock of X, clock of Y, and basically that's it. All of these are again working. So in case that you want to try them, feel free to basically just create the appropriate files and run them. Okay, let me actually show it to you. Okay, so this is the class clock animation, which is our main class. Then we have the class clock pane. So let's create it. Okay. We need the entire class. And now we run it. And as we saw before, we run the clock animation main method, main class. It basically has a clock that moves every second. Okay. Good. Bouncing ball. So again, this is another example. If you want to implement Pong or a classic ping pong game, you will need something like this, a rectangle that contains classes that are updated, that contains balls. So the ball pane is our main class. and we run it. Actually, we need to implement the control that is actually the main Java application. Okay. And here we have the ball. If you press up, it will increase its speed because it's set that the event handler of up is incrementing the speed with 2 pixels per round. And it can get quite fast. In fact, I've seen a lot of games implemented in Java itself because it's relatively an easy program to run, to write. JavaFX also supports mobile devices, and if you develop a JavaFX application for a desktop or a laptop that has screen swipes, I don't, but if you do, you can basically use these event types. Okay, so that's all that I wanted to tell you today about event handlers. So let's see if there are more questions. So CirclePane was an inner class, and it can be public, private, or protected. Yes, it can be protected, and then subclasses can inherit them. You can't declare multiple public classes in the same file. The only public class is the name of the file. You can define inner classes without creating an outer class. Yes, because you can basically use the same the constructor outside, like in the main method. And new outer class period the inner class. And then you actually just created an inner class object. If the outer class and the inner class, if the inner class is private, then you basically you cannot create an instance outside that file. Okay, good. So I'm going to stop this recording and then do a separate recording for the lab.